Penguin Random House Audio presents Unsub by Meg Gardiner. Read for you by Hilary Huber. For Shane Salerno. Whoever fights monsters should see to it that in the process, he does not become a monster. And if you gaze long enough into an abyss, the abyss will gaze back into you. Friedrich Nietzsche. April, 1998. The yelling woke her, the rough voice of her father shouting into the phone. "Listen to me. We don't have days, we have hours." The black sky poured through the bedroom window. Shadows crawled along the ceiling. "Don't you understand? It's in his message. Mercury rises with the sun." Caitlin curled into a ball, hugging her bear. She knew what Mercury meant. It meant flashing lights and breaking news and everybody so scared. A body bag sliding into the coroner's black van. Killer claims eighth victim. It meant you could never close your eyes or turn your back because he could get you anytime, anywhere. "He's telling us flat out, when the sun comes up, he's going to kill again." And her dad had to stop it. That's why each word Mac Hendrix spoke sounded angrier than the last. Why his shirt was dirty and he hadn't shaved in 3 days. And when he came home for an hour, he ignored dinner and the Warriors game and her. Why he paced and stared at the walls and yelled into the phone. The back door creaked. "Because I've goddamn worked this case for 5 years. I know." Caitlin slid from under the covers and crept to the window. Her dad stepped outside, lit a cigarette, and stalked across the backyard. Lights reflected on his gun and detective's shield. His shoulders were bent. That frightened her. The wind blurred his words. She tiptoed from her room. Her parents' door was shut, Mom asleep. She slipped into the kitchen to the open window to hear what he was saying. "We work the evidence. We keep working. Or somebody dies." She stopped. The door into the garage was open a crack. The rule was, never go in the garage unless Dad says it's okay. He spread files on the workbench in there, all his information. But sometimes he let her in to help stack his papers. Her stomach knotted. She looked out the kitchen window again into the backyard. The cigarette glowed red. Answers were in the garage. Truth. She edged to the door and stole through. She stopped, bare feet cold on the concrete. The walls were covered with photos. Faces. Flesh. Open eyes, jagged slices, blood. Her head began to pound. A plastic bag on a screaming face, bite marks, dogs. At the edges of her vision, starlight shivered. A cut. A cut. He cut with a knife in the person's chest. A dead person. She's dead. A sound rose from her throat. He cut a picture into the woman. Stick figure. It. She turned in a slow circle. She saw dangling feet, Frankenstein stitches, an arm with words scrawled on it. Despair. Her legs started to shake. The cuts, the cuts, the cuts. The sign. Dizzy, she turned. The photos seemed to lunge and wail. Devil man, him, him. She pressed her hands over her mouth, but the sound grew louder. Footsteps pounded through the kitchen. The door banged open.
"Jesus, no."
Her dad charged in, mouth wide, eyes burning. The sound poured from her throat, uncontrollable screams. He swept her in his arms.
"Don't look, Caitlin. Close your eyes."
She buried her face in his chest, but the photos howled and clawed. She sobbed, clutching him, feeling him shake. The work of the killer was everywhere. Mercury, the messenger, the prophet. They were surrounded. Chapter 1. Equinox, present day. Weapon at her side, eyes on the night, Caitlin approached the house. Fog clung to the ground, rolling thick off San Francisco Bay. It hid the stars, their faces, the view beyond. Silently, they climbed the steps to the broad porch. The March chill weaveled down Caitlin's arms. By the doorbell, a faded sticker announced that Jesus saves, but Caitlin saw no evidence of it. Not tonight, she thought. Tonight, he didn't get the call. They stacked up beside the door. Behind drawn blinds, a television burbled. Intel suggested that six people were inside, but suggested didn't mean confirmed. Caitlin's heart beat hard against her ballistic vest. Beneath it, she wore a t-shirt, jeans, and work boots. Her auburn hair was tucked beneath a ball cap. Her nerves were tuned to an ultra-high frequency, adrenaline crackling through her like static, waiting for the sign. The raid leader held up a fist. The team stilled. Rios was an Oakland Police Department sergeant, built like a furnace in black tactical gear. He glanced at them over his shoulder. Oakland Police, San Francisco PD, Alameda County. Caitlin's vest read, Sheriff. Her ball cap read, Narcotics Task Force. They gave him a thumbs up. The moments before, the suspense always fried her. Anticipation was hell, the hateful uncertainty. The house was two-story, decrepit, secretly humming with danger. Caitlin hugged the stucco wall, Sig Sauer warm in her hand. At her back, a young Alameda sheriff's deputy named Marston thrummed with apprehension. Come on, she thought. Jesus might not get the call tonight, but we're here. Let's move. Rios raised his semi-automatic rifle and pounded on the door. Police! A dog barked. The TV droned. Rios drew back his arm to pound on the door again. A gunshot from inside blew splinters across the porch. The static in Caitlin's nerves resolved to a clear tone. Here we go. Inside the house, feet pounded. Men yelled. Rios tested the doorknob. Locked. He signaled the fourth man in the stack, an Oakland cop who held the little pig. Caitlin braced for more gunfire. The Oakland cop, Hillier, rounded them and aimed the little pig at the deadbolt. The scaled-down shotgun was loaded with a breaching round. He fired from an inch away. The deadbolt assembly blew into the house, and Hillier stepped aside. The door yawned open. The master key. It worked on any lock. Rio said, Go, go! Rifle to his shoulder, he led the formation in. The lights were dim, the floor warped. Tight and fluid, they swept into the hall. Rio aimed ahead, then to the right. Right, clear, he said. Caitlin stepped to the left, pistol level, checked her sector. Left, clear. The hall reeked of sulfur and ammonia. At the back of the house, a battering ram smashed open the rear door. Marston stepped past her, checked his sector. Clear. They closed up behind Rios, left hands on the shoulder of the person in front of them, and advanced to the wide doorway to the living room. Rios pointed. Go. He swung in. Drop it, he yelled. A gun clattered to the floor. Caitlin came in behind him. Again, she checked her sector. Rios yelled, Get down! And peripherally, she saw a man drop to his knees. She said, Left, clear! Rios kicked a handgun away from the suspect and held his rifle on him while Marston and Hillier swept the room. All clear! Down the hall, men shouted. Footsteps raced back and forth. Rios pointed at Caitlin and Marston and put two fingers to his eyes. Kitchen, go! Caitlin returned to the hall. At the far end, men grabbed stacks of cash and fled with officers in pursuit. She advanced toward the kitchen door, weapon level, finger on the trigger. Her pulse pounded in her ears. The kid, Marston, closed up behind her. His breath warmed her neck. She was taller than he was, 5'10", and, for the moment, a shield. In another room, someone shouted and slammed into a wall. "Clear!" an officer shouted. The stench of ammonia burned her throat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.